What a privilege it is to know and serve the Lord. Amen. A couple of announcements we want to remind you of tonight. And if you're joining us online, God bless you. Great to have you with us. Good Friday service, 2 days from now, 7 p.m. And there's a flyer in the foyer that has directions and the address of where this community Good Friday service is going to be held. We're excited to do this year, just to, as one church, the body of Christ in our community, to come together and just worship the Lord and point as many people as we can to the person of Jesus Christ. Amen. Glorious day, that Good Friday, when our Lord gave his life for our sin, but of course, 3 days later comes Sunday, and we'll celebrate that. Amen. With one service, 11 a.m., the whole family together, kids with us, performing for us, and we love that, don't we? And then a big, massive carnival barbecue afterward. And so be a part of that. There's still an opportunity for you to find a place to serve. You can see Delphina. She's right here in the front, raising her hand. If you'd like to be a part of that, there's a spot for you to fill. And so don't miss an opportunity, but it's going to be a wonderful time. Pray for the absence of any and all clouds. We'll take a couple, but no rain clouds. And we'll see what happens. We are flexible. Amen. And then lastly, just one more thing. Our women's conference is coming up. It's the first weekend in May, the 1st through the 3rd. And so we'll be taking signups from that starting tonight. And there's a deposit that holds your place that's given at the time of registration. And so make sure, ladies, this is your retreat. Elbow your men. And men, you better step up and send our ladies to go sit at Jesus' feet. No kids. No other duties other than to just, for once in a year, sit at the feet of our Lord and just be blessed and refreshed. Amen? Invest in your wives, men. Other than that, Pastor Tony's going to lead our study tonight. I'm so excited to see what the Lord's going to say. Come on up, brother.
Good evening. This has been a busy week. This is a really busy week. It's going to continue. And as Pastor Aaron said on Friday, the community of churches is going to get together and worship together. And there'll be, I think, four pastors speaking that night. And our pastor, Pastor Aaron, will be one of those. So it's we just pray that you can join us that night. And because it was so busy, he asked me if I would fill in tonight. So I always absolutely say yes. And then I always think that was a little quick. but it's such a privilege to be before you tonight. And, you know, it's a week that I think that is like no other week. And I'm going to share that a little bit. I'm not going to share, I mean, I think you know the story I'm going to tell you. But let's go before the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this evening. We just thank you, Lord. We thank you for who you are, for the love that you have continuously shown for us. So represented this week, Lord. Your Son paying for everything, Lord. So, Father, we pray that you are just with us in a special way tonight, that this is what we're doing, our worship, your message, Lord, is just pleasing to you, and that you would just work through this lowly servant, Lord, to deliver that. So we lift this prayer up in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, this isn't going to be a long message, so I'm hoping it's going to hit a perfect chord But I do want to start by saying, you know, I was saved in my late 30s. And until that time, this week was just, for me, a little pomp and ceremony. You know, it was Easter eggs and bunnies and, I don't know, candy, chocolate rabbits, if there is such a thing. There is, because I've eaten a few. But since I've been saved, this particular week has taken such a, it just makes me refocus how much God loved me, what he did to get me back in his family. It's just a special time for me. So I'm going to share a few things tonight, and hopefully they'll hit a chord with you. You know, it helps me to think that as we go through life, we learn really how quickly things change. Especially like in California, there'll be a sunny day. Next minute, maybe an earthquake. We're feeling financially secure, and in today's world, you get the call that your credit card has been stolen, your identity has been stolen. And sudden loss of a job, maybe. Or even a dear loved one, and we've had that recently. We probably all could think, I'm sure we could, of days or moments when something happened to completely change what was just happening maybe a moment or just a bit prior. So thinking in that context, I think last Sunday was Palm Sunday, and we celebrated, you know, the triumphant entry of Jesus, our Lord, into the city of Jerusalem prior to the what they call the high holiday, the Passover feast. He entered the city on the road from Bethany and Bethpage, and that's just below the Mount of Olives. And you know the story. He rode on a colt of a donkey, as prophesied by Zechariah, and a multitude of his disciples followed him into the city toward the temple. According to Luke 19:37, when he reached the place where the road started down the Mount of Olives, all of his followers began to shout and sing. And as they walked along, praising God for all the miracles, the wonderful miracles that they had seen just prior to that, in that week. Yet, how quickly things change. A week later, that same multitude of disciples followed him out of the city, what? To see him crucified. The week before, when the multitude rejoiced, they praised God with one loud voice, saying, "Praise God, blessing the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hail to the King of Israel." The following week, Roman soldiers stripped him of his clothing and put a scarlet robe on him. They wove thorn branches into a crown and put it on his head, and they placed a reed in his right hand as a scepter, and then they knelt before him in mockery and taunted, "Hail, King of the Jews." The following week, Jesus was strapped to the branches of a tree, and his own clothing were laid down before the people at the foot of the cross. The week before, he taught the people daily in the temple, and he told them in a parable of their great king that would someday come. All the nations will be gathered in his presence, and he will separate the people as the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep at his right hand, and the goats on his left. That following week, the great king was lifted on a cross. In Matthew 27:38, two criminals were crucified with him, one on his right hand and the other on his left. It's as though that then and there Jesus was beginning the fulfillment of Isaiah 53:12, where it says that he will die with transgressors. So how quickly things changed that week is one of the lessons maybe we can get from Gethsemane, the cross, and the garden tomb. Normally we refer to this story as the atonement and the resurrection. But tonight I'm going to focus on the details of Gethsemane, the cross, and the garden tomb. And it has been called the greatest story ever told. So let's start with Gethsemane. And again, I know I'm, as they say, preaching to the choir. But I love this story. I love the transition that goes through that whole week, the change that occurs, and the outcome at the end. Someone I loved very deeply said, you know, the story is always the same, but it's what you get out of it or the application that we take away from it. So let's see if we can dig down into this a little bit and see if we can pull something. I know I can pull something out for myself. Hopefully I can pull something out that you'll recognize. So Jesus and his disciples took part in the Passover meal. And the taking of the bread and the wine. And if you just think about that one act, there Jesus transformed that ceremony or that ritual or that custom into symbols of the New Testament, the water and the wine. Then according to Matthew 26:30, he and the disciples sang a hymn and went out to the Mount of Olives. In Matthew 26:36-38, we learn, and then Jesus went with them to the olive grove called Gethsemane. And he said, "Sit here while I go over there to pray." And he took Peter and Zebedee's two sons, James and John, and he became anguished and distressed. He told them, "My soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. My soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here," he told them. "Stay here and keep watch with me." Continuing in Luke 22, he walked away about a stone's throw. So maybe some of you can throw pretty good, maybe a little less, but even the best one in here, that's not that far away. So he walked about a stone's throw away and he knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine." Then an angel from heaven appeared and strengthened him. He prayed more fervently and he was in such agony of spirit that his sweat fell to the ground like great drops of blood. The atonement for the sins of humanity had begun in earnest. He was pained at every turn from every side. There was no relief. He was crushed with grief to the point of death. It's as though like the only escape for that would be death. And that would be the only escape for this experience he was feeling. You know, Jesus had wept at the tomb of Lazarus. So he was acquainted with grief, but the experience of Gethsemane was something altogether different. He who had never sinned and had not known firsthand the consequences of sin was now experiencing such sin and its consequences again and again. Jesus was experiencing it for every single individual in the human family. For all of us right here. Now, something very important for each of us personally occurred during that hour. Christ not only suffered for mine and your sins, but he prevailed over them. He prevailed over him. He did not simply feel mine and your pain, but he conquered them. And this is kind of like at the very heart of that miracle. Jesus fully identified with our emotional, spiritual, and physical sickness. He did not succumb to it. He did not react to it as I possibly would have, being defensive, maybe arrogant, self-justification. If he would have done that, and he would have yielded to sin. Instead, Jesus maintained the integrity of his own love, and therefore, by absorbed and absolved the sins for each of us personally. Jesus suffered all of me and you. Not only our sin, but our character flaws, our sorrow, our pain, our very negative experience, and he prevailed over it all, still sinless. He had already overcome the world for himself before he ever entered into the Garden of Gethsemane. And when he left that garden, he had also overcome the world for each of us. As we accept him, we also accept his victory over us. So I said a little bit earlier, about a stone's throw, he left the disciples, and he told them what? I'm going to go over there and pray. So he has just gone. His spirit is crushed. He's overcome all these things. He's felt all these pains. He's felt the consequences of sin, even though he's never sinned. So at that moment, where were his disciples? Mark 14:38 tells us, then he returned and found the disciples asleep. You remember that. He said to Peter, Simon, and he probably said it, I don't know how he said it. If it was me, I would have said, Simon, are you asleep? I'd have been so incredulous about it. But he probably said, Simon, are you asleep? Couldn't you even watch for 1 hour for me? 1 hour. Keep watch and pray so that what? You will not give in to temptation. And we all know the saying for the what? Spirit is willing, but the body or the flesh is weak. So if you think about it, the greatest single event of human history was underway, well underway. And his closest friends were what? Sleeping through it. The whole world was being healed, and not a person was even aware of it. And then, as you know, one of the 12 came with a multitude and betrayed him with a kiss, which was, you know, it's a universal sign of affection. And Jesus was arrested. But Jesus had already declared his intention and surrendered to the will of the Father by assuming the sins of mankind. He now had to carry all those sins to the cross for that final offering. So, I challenged myself, I challenged you. You know, are we ready to keep watch and pray for the Lord so we don't give in to temptation? Are we ready to observe and witness the great things of our God, the great things he has done for us? Or are we too tired, spiritually worn out, or distracted that we, as the disciples did, fall asleep or are not aware when God is either showing us something or leading us in the direction he wants us to go? Are we ready to keep watch and pray? So let's look at the cross. You know, under Jewish law, the death penalty, I think, could only be executed by, I think, strangulation, beheading, burning, or stoning. none great, but all, you know, a relatively quick punishment compared to crucifixion. Crucifixion, instead, was a Roman punishment for slaves and the lowest of criminals, and only Romans at that time were permitted to execute someone. Last Saturday, I don't know if some of you were there for the prime timers, our get-together. Albert Ng shared a message. And he shared some insight. Delfino, you remember that. That was great. He shared some insight of why Pilate gave in to the Jewish council. You know, remember, Pilate had him in, talked to him, and Pilate went off and said, I don't find him guilty of anything. And they went on and it went around, and Herod came and went through that, came back to Pilate. Some of the background, I think, that Albert was sharing was that Herod was in Jerusalem because he was not in the good graces of Pilate or of Caesar. And so Jerusalem was like this outcast, and he didn't want to tick another thing up against with Caesar. But as long as the Jews or the council were saying he is blaspheming God, you know, it wasn't a big deal. No. What they did do was changed the charges from blasphemy to basically treason. He calls himself a king. Remember, Herod asked him, are you the king of the Jews? And Jesus just said, you said it. So when it became treason, then it became a charge against Caesar. And Herod had to act on that. And because he did, that brought crucifixion into it on a cross, and it would fulfill the prophecy. So as part of the punishment, remember, Jesus was required to carry his own cross, the Golgotha, and he faltered due to the suffering. He experienced in Gethsemane and then all that was done to him during his trial. He lacked the physical strength to carry his own cross, which makes the willingness of the Spirit even more amazing. The cruelty of death on the cross is its consciousness. Think about that. The cruelty of the cross is its consciousness. For hours, the victim would hang there without any relief in unconsciousness. It was not like a lapse into shock, but it was a prolonged, conscious realization that life was slowly slipping away. I think that's why the custom was developed of giving a condemned, you know, immediately before the execution, a drink of wine mingled with mirth. But Jesus refused it because the effect of the drink was what? It's really to dull the nerves, to provide an anesthetic for the agony. But Jesus nevertheless maintained complete consciousness throughout. The atonement would be fully and completely performed, untainted by a narcotic. So it's interesting why he was on the cross, the statements that he made. And he made seven of them, as we read through there. Just seven statements. In Luke 23:35, he says, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Luke 23:43, to the thief beside him, he said, I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise. His third statement was John 19:26-27. To his mother, he said, dear woman, here is your son. And he was referring to John, the beloved disciple. And to John, he said, here's your mother. So from noon, Jesus hung on the cross for about 3 hours. And when the darkness came at about mid-afternoon, then his fourth statement was, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, my God, why have you abandoned me? Now, according to one author, the agony of the Garden of Gethsemane was returned, intensified beyond human power to endure. In that bitterest hour, the dying Christ was alone, alone in the most terrible reality, that the supreme sacrifice of a son might be consummated in all its fullness. The Father seems to have withdrawn the support of his immediate presence, leaving the Savior of men the total glory of complete victory over the forces of sin and death. After this, the atonement was complete. Jesus had fulfilled his mission to all others, and for once, could finally think of himself when he made his fifth statement in John 19:28. Remember what he said? I'm thirsty. It's so unbelievable. After all he's gone through, he's been on the cross for 3 hours. His statement is, I am thirsty. A jar of, they had some sour wine, some describe it as, or it's kind of like kind of water and vinegar, I think. It was kind of a common drink for Roman soldiers at the time. They soaked a sponge in it and put it on a branch and held it up to him. And that was prophesied in Psalm 69:21. They offered me sour wine for my thirst. And when Jesus received the sour wine, he made his sixth statement. He said, it is finished. And then he uttered his last and final statement, as recorded in Luke 23:46. He said, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. So when Jesus died, he died with the Holy Scriptures in his heart and his lips to the very last. Some of the things as I go through there, we need to remember that because of the cross, what? Jesus took away all our sins. All the different ways we have rebelled against God. All those moments of mocking and doubting God in our minds. Jesus on the cross paid for all those sins. Because of the moment on the cross, Jesus offers us what? Unconditional pardon. A clean slate. The sure hope of eternal life with him. So lastly, let's look at the garden tomb. Now, since the Sabbath was coming, Jesus' body was quickly laid in this garden tomb. And 3 days later, in the emptiness of the tomb, the Savior had transformed all of that completely into pure joy and triumph. Nothing was left to be done. And this is the real message of the greatest story ever told. We can take from that what so often hurts us and burdens us, Christ overcame forever. No matter what happens to us from here, we are met at the last with resurrection. Our spirit and our body are reunited forever in fullness of joy. From the moment Jesus walked into Gethsemane to the hours on the cross to the moment when the garden tomb was found empty, the atonement was completed. And first revealed to humanity when Jesus said in John 20:16, Mary. Now remember that Mary Magdalene was standing outside the tomb crying because she believed that Jesus had taken, body had been taken away. She turned to leave and saw someone standing there. It was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. Jesus asked her, dear woman, why are you crying? Who are you looking for? She thought he was a gardener. Sir, she said, if you have taken him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will go and get him. And Jesus said, Mary. And Mary Magdalene turned to him, recognized him, and cried out, Rabboni, which is Hebrew for teacher. So Jesus chose to reveal himself first to a single individual. You know, that he now had risen. It was, atonement was complete. And in that moment, he kind of set an example or taught the woman that atonement is utterly personal. Jesus told her to go find my brothers and tell them I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. So Mary Magdalene found the disciples and told them, I have seen the Lord. She gave him his message. Finally, when the Savior appeared to the 12, it is recorded in Luke 24:48 that he said, you are my witnesses of all these things. So what were they witnesses of? They were witnesses of Gethsemane, the cross, and the garden tomb. We are also to be witnesses of these things, not only during this time, Easter Sunday, but every day of our life. So I ask you, during this week, and as we celebrated Palm Sunday and we go forth on Friday to partake in that worship of God on Good Friday, and then Resurrection Sunday, Easter Sunday, let me go back to those three things. R1, are we ready to keep and watch and pray for the Lord? Are we ready to keep watch and pray for the Lord? 2, will we share that because of the cross Jesus took all our sins away and that Jesus offers an unconditional pardon, a clean slate, the sure hope of eternal life? Will we share that with others? And 3, will we remember that what so often hurts and burdens us, Christ has already overcome it forever. So let me say in closing that on this Good Friday, remember that the cross does not answer why God loves us, but it does answer the question of how much. In Romans 5:8, God showed how much he loved us by having Christ die for us even though we were sinful. So we want to remember that God does not love us because Christ died for us, but Christ died for us because God loved us so much. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm just at a loss for words right now, Father. It just seems we are so unworthy. It's hard to comprehend how much you love us. Lord, it's a time to acknowledge your Son, that he paid for all of our sins. Father, we pray that those things that happen, we would just be witnesses for and share with others. And that we would be ready to keep watch and pray for you constantly to keep ourselves out of temptation. Dear Lord, thank you. Thank you for this evening. Thank you for allowing us to come into your presence. Father, we think of the next couple of days, the next few days, and we just give you the praise and the honor and the glory. Lord, that sounds not quite enough. I wish I could think of the biggest word that said thank you. But we thank you, Lord. And we pray this prayer in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. So if you have any need for prayer, we'll be up front to pray for you. Just like to remind you, if you can make the Friday at 7 o'clock, it'd be great. It's an opportunity to be with some other churches in our community and to really honor that day. So you don't have to go home right away. Visit for a little bit, but God bless you.
My